So hello. Yes, for Paris you can come when you want. We have a new office with an open space for contributors, so they can come the morning, stay all day long, have coffee, beers, whatever. So this is not the main goal of the talk. The first thing is that I want to ask you a question about how many of you in this room has written an application that works for Android and iOS and maintains it? Can you raise your hand? Okay, how many of you likes it? Okay, two and a half. So some of my colleagues told me when I was saying I'm going to give a talk here, oh, you know, there is no space for a third platform, third mobile platform. And actually, that's true. So nobody wants to write an application three times. Nobody wants to maintain it. That's too much of a pain. So the easy solution is just write it once. But obviously, there is no simple, old, mature, stable technology that works on across all devices. Oh, wait, there is one. There is web technologies, but they run in a web browser. That's not really the platform you're working on. And it does not let you access hardware capabilities of the device. Well, again, OK, maybe with PhoneGap, you can do that. You can access hardware capabilities of the device. That's really good. And so what we are trying to do here as Mozilla is to go further, to see how we can push the web and how we can make an OS with it. So I'm not Andreas Gall. Andreas Gall was supposed to make the talk today, and he has been unable to make it. So I'm going to give the talk with this slide. So if you have any complaints, just send a mail to him. So the first... So the first thing is, probably most of you already knows what is Mozilla. But just want to remember that Mozilla is a non-profit foundation that owns a corporation that works on making the web a better place. So we have around 650 employees across the world. And we have a new office in Paris with probably 20 employees for a big office. So again, feel free to come and say hello. And what makes us different is these non-profit things. We are not trying to gain any advantages. We are working with volunteers. So Firefox, for example, is our main tool, and it is translated in 80 languages and a bit more. And all these translations are done by volunteers. So if you are making an application and with a big application, you know it's very expensive. And hopefully, we have a lot of volunteers that works sometime very early before release, or very late, like the day before. They are amazing. So we have some values at Mozilla. I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but we want to promote innovation and openness. We want to make the web a better place. And it has started when, back in the days, some of you may remember this, like the web in 2002, there was all those banners for this website is optimized for IE. And that was really a crap. So, and Mozilla kicks in and not the web is, all web pages have used open standards. There is a few actors, well, a lot of web, of browser vendors that run fast and very nice engine. So the good thing about this competition is that that makes us do a better place for the web. So this is, on the right, what you see is the performance of the JavaScript engine. So because there is a competition, people need to do the best implementation. So there is a huge fight around that, and you try it around rendering engine, all this stuff. So competition is good, and that's what we want to promote. We don't want to own the web. We just want to promote competition and openness. So So you're going to say this is good, this is the web, this is not mobile. So it's not, why do we care? If you look today at the mobile landscape, if you think about it, you say it's not that different from 2002. It's not, there is a lot of silos. There is Android, there is Windows, iOS, and all of those comes with their services, their platform, and they left behind the users, the developers, OEM. It's not the way we are seeing it. It's not what we tried to do for the web. It's not what Mozilla wants for mobile. So what we plan is to change this with two things, innovation and open standards. So we changed the desktop, we went to change the mobile, and some people may ask, oh, you say openness and you work very closely with operators and OEM, and that's because of the distribution channel. We don't want to make only a phone that works for geeks that are going to install it on their phone during the weekend. I want my mom to go in a shop and to buy a phone with Firefox OS. Because those end users are our targets. So moving all those silos to use open standards will, again, make the computation better. That will force different implementation to use those standards. And so Google and Apple, so WebKit, or maybe no, there is Blink, but that's still the same, will move to those standards and there will be a nice competition around that. So bringing the web is not enough. The web right now does not let you play with the hardware capabilities of the device. So we also want to standardize a set of APIs to let you access the camera, the telephony, the SMS, contacts database, everything. And we want those APIs not only for the device, not only for the mobile as a native API, wanted for the web. So today, for example, if you use the latest version of WebKit, or if you use Firefox Nightly, you can use some of those APIs in your website. Like you can use the vibration API, so your website can provide a feedback to the user. You can use the battery API. So all those API, we try to bring them to the web, not only to the device itself. Sorry. So all those obviously with web technologies that are already known and so on. So let's speak a little more about the operating system itself. So the main difference is that we don't have any native API stack. Everything is based on, you have basically a kernel, Gecko, and a front-end. So the front-end is a pure HTML front-end, which is powered by web technologies and web content. So what do you do as an application developer to bring content or to create an application? So how do you bring web content as a first-class citizen of the operating system? How do you make those web technologies the main key to create an app that works cross-platform? There is a different few things here. So what we are trying to promote is open web apps. This is a standard that will work across all browsers, across all platforms, to wrap some HTML and let it run as an application on any HTML5 runtimes. What it means every HTML5 runtimes is Gecko, so Firefox, Chrome, Opera, Safari, and everything that runs HTML5 today. This is very easy. You take some HTML, you just create a little JSON meta file that describes a name, an icon, some localizable properties. You can also give permissions, this kind of stuff. Obviously, we want the APIs to be secure. You just take your website and this, you shake, and then you have an app. And to install those applications, we use the same thing as others. You have a way, we will have a marketplace to install them. You have a JavaScript API that lets you trigger an installation of your application from your website. But I have heard since the beginning of the project so many times, well, this is the web. It does not work offline. You need a connection. And that's completely wrong. So the web so you have different way of making your application work offline. You can use the app cache standard, or you can use you can package your application. So if some people know about app cache, some people also call it app cache is a Dutch bag, because it's a really painful standard. So we are currently working on making something better. We realize that app cache does not really fit, and the implementation on the browsers does not really fit with the performance of the device, the way the database is stored. But that's some platform level issue. So we also, with this API, we want to provide more stuff with apps. You don't want to install your application only from a store, and you want this store. It could be your store, your website. It could be, maybe you want to share an application. You want to use Bluetooth to give an application to your friend. Because if you target some country where internet, you don't have a permanent internet access like Brazil, you want a better way to share apps. You want maybe to discover apps when you need them. Like, I'm going to share this web content. I can share it on, I don't know, Twitter, Facebook, and maybe something else. What about suggestion for that? So this is another standard called Web Activities. It is a, so Web Activities is a subset of Web Intents. And we took Web Intents, we broke it into multiple parts, and we are going to try to standardize some of it. We are also providing an identity system where, so you can look, you can have more information on this on our website. It's a way to have one identity and many providers. So let's talk a bit about Gaia. So let's see what time is it, how much time I have. Nice. So I said, we want HTML to be a first-class citizen. I said it can do native stuff. It can be to have the same performance as native UI, and sometimes to beat it, even. So how do we ensure this? How do we make sure this promise is true? So all the UI of the phone is made with HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So everything is the same, everything is an application. So the system application, so the main thing that manage windows, all the windows that manage dialogues, pop-ups for select, this kind of stuff, this is an application. The home screen is an application, the settings, everything is an application. So let's see if that's true, and let's see if I can just try in front of you to change the UI of the system app.
So I think...
Okay, wake up. Let me enable this. Display. Alors. Okay, never up.
I can turn it around that it's facing you.
I think it's okay. I don't need a very good resolution. So this is Gaia. This is the UI of the phone. Let's see. I told you we can... So, for example, if I want to change... The status bar is part of the system. So, up. I'm going to try to flash the app live to see if I can just tweet some CSS to change the system to see if it's really HTML or not. As you can see at the top of the phone, the status bar is black if the phone wants to stay on. And here is the CSS that describes this status bar. And it says background color black. So let's try to turn it to something like transparent so it would look better. Okay. Let's flash the phone. Up. Let me plug it. Okay. So what is it doing now? So it. This is the system app, so the phone restarts, and let's see the status bar. So yeah, it works. That's, oh, everything is like this, only CSS, HTML, JavaScript. So again, what do we offer as a developer environment? Is it just this command line stuff that looks really creepy? Maybe we can do better. Let's see. Maybe we can try to see if it's really HTML. Hey, it works in Firefox as well. So now, maybe I can start to use some Firefox tools, like my web console, web inspector. And let's see. I want to change. So it's not really easy this way. Let's see, if I want to change the status bar, that's the same idea. Up. I can click on it, and I will see the property here. Oh, I can, let me scroll. Okay. Okay, it's not really easy. Oh, maybe Maybe I don't like this, I prefer red. Yes. So we offer the same, that same tool than a regular HTML environment. So there is no need to learn something new, no need to have new tools that makes you feel bad when you're on Windows, or you can just use HTML and the regular tools on Firefox, or you can use Firebug or whatever you want as a web developer. So let's try to go back to this presentation. So to have the same performance as native UI when we scroll or pan, for example, I don't know if the camera renders well or not. I don't see it. So to have the same kind of performance, we use some tricks. We can use the GPU with HTML. So if you should never use left or top as HTML properties to move the things on the screen. You should use the CSS transform, for example. And there is some optimization in browser where if the view is smaller than the screen or have the exact same size, if it appears on the screen, it will be pre-rendered, and then you can have some fast animation and some fast transitions. Well, that's again some old screenshot of Gaia. We tried many things. I think I have seen an Alcatel device with Firefox OS on one of the booths there. So if some of you has not seen it, it's just over there. So you will be able to play with Gaia and see how it performs on a real device. Let's see. And also I promise that it will not be only Firefox or Gecko. That's the same thing. We are trying to provide open standards. So what it means is, this is a public mailing list. This is a W3C mailing list. So if you want to change the web, if you want to change the framework of tomorrow, you can already send mails, you can discuss the APIs. And for example, this is an example of the Vibration API that has been implemented by Samsung into WebKit. And as a standard, so you can change the way the future of the APIs. We are developing in real time. The roadmap is public, and all the source code is done in real time on GitHub. And you can reach all developers on IRC and so on. So I said first, why there is no place for a third platform. So HP failed, Microsoft will fail. Sorry if there is any Microsoft person in this room. So why do we succeed? Why B2G is going to succeed? Why is it an interesting platform? Why is it not something useless to learn and to say, oh, I did it, it was nice, in a few months? There is tons of websites, tons of web contents, tons of potential apps, hundreds of thousands of virtually B2G developers, or HTML5 system developers, if you prefer. So everything is here. It just, they were just waiting for something to happen. So, again, some screenshots. If you want to contribute, as I said, everything is in. So this is an open source project. The code of the platform of the, so this platform part, so we call it Gonk. The Gecko part and Gaia part, everything is on internet, on Mercurial, GitHub, or whatever. So if you want to contribute, you just have to check out the code and make some patches. As you have seen, it's just HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. You have access to all the developers, so you can discuss with them and change what we are going to release later this year. So we plan to release later this year. I forgot to say that too. So Q&A, let's see if there is any questions.
Is the mic working?
Yes. Okay, we are taking some questions. Who's first? Who has some questions in regards to this Firefox OS? Okay, that's the first question.
What's up with the live demo?
Okay, do you want to demo the device for like 5 minutes? Is this the question? You want to see what's on the device?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
Sorry. I forgot. I'm too used to see it, so I completely forgot this part. Let's see. So this one is a old Geeks Phone device. It's not the final Geeks Phone one. It's an old one. So let's see. I'm on the wrong. So as you may expect from a device, he has an home screen, a status bar with notification. He can make phone calls, obviously. You can receive SMSs. So even the keyboard is in HTML, so you can change the keyboard, write a new one. So for keyboard, it was, and word suggestion, it was a bit, that was a very hard part to make as an HTML application. Like, the performance of our keyboard are really tricky to reach. So we are still fixing some bugs. Let's see. And yeah, as Mozilla, we are making a new web browser again. So we made Firefox, obviously on desktop, Firefox mobile, and this version of a smaller Firefox.
What application suite is included in Firefox OS? You have shown the dialer, SMS,
yeah.
Browsers naturally included.
Yeah, browser is naturally included. So, and for all device capabilities, camera settings that can let you change Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, a lot of APN things and SDK stuff, which is mostly for operators. FM radio, if your phone has a FM radio chip, you can access it.
Can you just go through it and shortly open the applications? I think this is what you are after, because I see so many curious faces here.
Let's see. I don't know if it's... So the camera, for example, it's not really easy to see it.
That's a camera application?
No, this is the camera is hard to see, because I can show you an example of the camera in this. For example, here, let's see. Oh. Fuck.
Should I help you with the mic? Then you
yes,
can
please.
Demonstrate.
Thank you.
Okay.
Seems like I'm unable to click on this stuff on the wrong side. Anyway, so if you want to see the camera, you can come after the show and I will show you. So, gallery.
I switch back. Okay.
So, I have more pictures on these other phones, so it will be easier to see scrolling. So this is a gallery application, if you want to see panning performances, for example.
And these pictures are now loading, or?
Yeah, this is some test database we have just to see with an AV gallery how well we support,
okay.
How well we scale.
And the gallery itself is programmed in HTML as well?
Oh yeah, everything you see on the screen is HTML. Even the status bar, and you can create new notification from your application using the desktop notification API, all standards API.
Okay.
So world clock, obviously, a calendar, email. So we also have, so if you do web development, you know that XML HTTP request does not let you do cross-domain requests. So you have to use some trick, use Flash, this kind of stuff. So we have added two things to the system. We have added a way to do cross-domain XML HTTP request, but we have also added a lower-level API, that's a TCP socket API, that lets you retrieve your mail. I don't think I have configured it, or maybe? Yeah. So this is my Gmail account, so I can do TCP, and we have rewritten an IMAP.js, POP.js, SMTP.js implementation on top of this TCP API. So we do not plan to create tons of protocols APIs. Instead, we just want to provide a TCP and a UDP API so people can do whatever they want, like do email application or control rebots, for example.
Can you show another application that uses a different API? Because I think the HTML accesses directly with JavaScript as a hardware. So which APIs have we seen so far?
Oh,
the camera you've shown?
I've shown the camera, TCP socket API. So the settings API, it's not really visible. Settings is just a way to control the hardware to turn them on or off of your device. So there is a Wi-Fi API as well to see, well, to connect to Wi-Fi.
And you're accessing via JavaScript now the hardware to enable Wi-Fi?
Yeah. We access, so we use JavaScript to access everything. If you want to have an idea about how does it look like as an API, I can show you after this, because I have some files with a presentation about all those APIs and how they look like in JavaScript.
Some API missing that you haven't shown us?
No? Well, so I said we took Web Intents, we divided in a few parts. So we took the, so if I want to show web activities, for example, let's say I'm going to my gallery and I want to share a picture. So this is web activity. This is also supposed to work with website. And I want to share these pictures. So all those apps as registers as a provider of the shared keyword, so they can share my pictures, and websites can do that as well, and can register as the same way. So if I want to share a picture, I can share it as a wallpaper, through Bluetooth, or through email. So this is one of the subset of Web Intents called Web Activities, which is in the standardization process. So we miss another part of Web Intents, which is more about content provider. So right now there is no way, no clean way for an application to expose its content to another application. So let's say if you want to create a search bar, there is no good way to look inside application. So there is no way to share information between application right now.
Okay, so some more questions to demonstrate or some